Welcome to our daily devotion. The Methodist Church of Barbados invites you to sing, pray, and worship with us as we declare God's glory and celebrate His mighty acts.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, your goodness has opened your hands to supply us with the needs of today, and your love has protected us from harm and danger and injury. But you have done more. You have opened your heart and drawn us closer to yourself with your forgiving mercies. Truly, you are wonderful, O God, merciful Father. Make us thankful every day for your many blessings. Let us count them one by one with a grateful heart. May I never forget your benefits when the desire of our heart has not as yet been granted. Too often we have forgotten to thank you for everyday blessings. We arose this morning and could walk. We opened our eyes and could see. We reached for our food and could enjoy it. O Lord, your blessings are many. Who could count them all? But how often we have forgotten to thank you for peace of mind, for cleansing of sin, for the air we breathe, the refreshing water we drink, the beauty of your creation, which we can behold. Lord, make us truly grateful and appreciative as we count our many blessings each and every day. Above all, we thank you that you have given us a Savior who walks with us, cleanses us from sin, and guides us daily in the paths of righteousness. In your grace, let us live today with a thankful heart for Jesus' sake. O God, I thank you also for the saving faith in Jesus Christ our Savior, for the privilege of being a Christian. Give us a deep and abiding faith and grant us the grace to show in all our actions and in all dealings with others, that you are the ruler of our hearts and minds, and that the joy of salvation is the dominating influence of our lives. Keep us from becoming discouraged by the troubles and cares of this life, and make us trusting, cheerful, and confident. At the same time, keep us humble always in the knowledge that salvation is from you, and that heaven is your gift. In gratitude for the salvation that you give, help us to live and die in the spirit of the psalmist. I will extol thee, my God and King, and bless thy name forever and ever. For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall laud thy works to another, and shall declare thy mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of thy majesty, and on thy wondrous works will I meditate. The Lord is graceful and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his compassion is over all that he has made. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and let us all bless his holy name forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Good evening, everyone. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting Father, all-knowing, all-powerful, but also all-merciful, we come before you this evening seeking your face. Let your Holy Spirit be with us this evening as we meditate on a portion of your scripture. Guide us and direct our thoughts that they may make clear to us your intentions for us as we strive to follow your footsteps. We thank you for hearing our prayer. Amen. The Bible lesson for this evening is taken from Genesis, and I'm reading from chapter 29. Just a few verses 15 to 28. And it goes like this. It's pretty well known, but this is how it goes. Then Laban said to Jacob, "Because you are my kinsman, should you therefore serve me for nothing? Tell me what your wages will be." Now Laban had two daughters. The name of the elder was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. Leah's eyes were lovely, but Rachel was graceful and beautiful. Jacob loved Rachel, so he said, "I will serve you for 7 years for your younger daughter, Rachel." Laban said, "It is better that I should give her to you than I should give her to any other man. Stay with me. So Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and they seemed to him but a few days because of the love that he had for her. Then Jacob said to Laban, give me my wife that I may go into her, for my time is completed. So Laban gathered together all the people of the place and made a feast. But in the evening, he took his daughter Leah and brought her to Jacob, and he went into her. Laban gave his maid Zilpha to his daughter Leah to be her maid. When morning came, it was Leah. And Jacob said to Laban, what is this you have done to me? Did I not serve you for Rachel? Why then have you deceived me? Well, Laban said, this is not done in our country, given the younger before the firstborn. Complete the week of this one, and we will give you the other also in return for serving me another 7 years. Well, Jacob did so and completed her week. And then Laban gave him his daughter Rachel as a wife. Laban gave his maid Bilhah to his daughter Rachel to be her maid. What a thing. The saga of Jacob, Laban, and Laban's daughters is interesting. One where we may be inclined to use the well-known phrase, what goes around comes around, meaning be careful, for your sins will catch you out. For if we are not careful with the way we choose to live our lives, our lives too can end up suffering a similar fate to that of Jacob, meeting our match, a kind of day of reckoning. A brief review of his story up to this point would remind us as to how he arrived at this position. He, with the help of his mother Sarah, conspired and was successful in tricking his old father Isaac to gain the birthright, rightfully belonging to his elder brother Esau. But then he had to beat a hasty retreat as his brother sought revenge. His mother packed him off to her brother Laban and her family, who lived some distance away. But he had to leave quickly and with virtually just the clothes on his back. The Bible lesson picks up on the scenario when he is in negotiation with Laban. My friends, I'm sure you know what it must be like engaging a family member to carry out some important tasks for you. Maybe some mason work on the house or some plumbing in the house, or even legal or medical work if that is their area. These types of negotiations can often be very tricky. But here it becomes even more complicated as it involves that great emotion, love. For you can see that Jacob's heart is so captured by the beauty of Rachel that he agrees to work 7 years to win her hand, a bit longer than the average courtship time, I wager. Laban's love, however, is centered on the well-being of both of his daughters. So the bride Jacob assumes is Rachel turns out to be his elder sister Leah. Some rabbis believe that just as Jacob had dressed like his brother Esau to trick Isaac, so Leah may have dressed as Rachel. When confronted, Laban seemed to state, well, that is just the way we do things around here. The younger can't go before the elder. That's tradition. Sometimes traditions can be great and a great help to define who we are as a group, as a people, as a church. For many of our Methodist traditions still serve us well, but others can become a hindrance over time, a hindrance to our spiritual and sometimes even the physical advancement of our faith, both as individuals and also as a church in total. And this is something thus that we always need to be on our guard with and always review to see if our traditions that we are following are still relevant to today. You know, we have changed many of our traditions in the way we have done things over the years, aided, if you can say, as a result of the virus and those changes that we have had. And perhaps looking forward, as the virus situation abates, we may start to look to see what we can retain and what we need to go back to. But I believe coming on to the end, it would be a change, and I believe a change for the better. Now, Laban's traditions worked against Jacob in this instance. Jacob the deceiver had been outfoxed. Yet Jacob's love is so great that he works yet another 7 years for the hand of Rachel, who the rabbis believe may very well have helped her sister Leah with the disguise to trick Jacob. So here we have conflicting loves. We have Jacob, who loves Rachel. We have Laban, who loves both of his daughters. Rachel loves her father and her sister Leah. How can all these conflicting loves come to a successful conclusion? And furthermore, Jacob will continue to be conflicted in his marriage situation as we read on. In real life, our lives are often filled with these types of conflicts. Conflicts between that are quite legitimate between conflicting loves. How do we allocate time and energy between spouse and children? Husbands often complain that they tend to take a second or third stage in that situation. Or between family and career. Wives often complain that they're taking a second stance to the husband's career, maybe increasingly now to the wife's career. What about personal commitments and the church? Pastors sometimes complain that finding enough persons who are competent but they have the time and the willingness to assist with the different committees and also organizations within the church, which keeps the church running, sometimes it's a challenge, as it seemed to fall on the shoulders of just a few. So these conflicts often challenge us to develop skills and discernment in giving each love its rightful due. Are you also faced with these kind of conflicts in your life? How do you work out? How do you work it out? And have you been successful? But how can we achieve this? Well, Jesus cautions us to let wisdom be in the service of love. He puts love over wisdom here. And we should always exercise consideration for others. That is, be as wise as serpents. Amen. Let us pray. In life, there are often so many conflicting interests. Yet, we are called to be of good service to all. But that should also include our well-being. But how can we achieve this balance? This is where the inspiration of your Holy Spirit can guide us, where your word can be a valuable source of guidance, where the Christian experience of mature brothers and sisters can also assist. For you said in your word, you would never leave us, and we know that you are readily accessible, always there, that we can call on you when we have these issues. So Almighty God, be with us then as we negotiate the challenges of our lives, and we thank you for the blessings that you bestow on us daily. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Oh, that deliverance for Israel would come from Zion. When God restores the fortunes of his people, Jacob will rejoice, Israel will be glad. Brothers and sisters, God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you, always having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. Beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. Brothers and sisters, go in peace, and may the God of peace go with you, now and forevermore. And the people of God say, Amen.
Of our daily devotion. We trust it has been a blessing to you. Now together, let us hold fast to his word, and may it dwell in all of us richly.